So I'm going to call up Pastor Adam, and he's going to share God's word this morning.
Thanks so much, Pastor Cully. Good morning, everybody. So let's just close our eyes and let's just pray and just ask God's blessing on the word. Father, we thank you for, firstly, we just want to bring Pastor Cully before you. Lord has, you know, spoke about, you know, just not feeling 100%. And we thank you that we worship the God who is the God that is our healer. We pray right now for over Pastor Cully. We speak healing over him. And even as he's in this season, God, I know it sounds weird, a season of almost incubation, God, I pray for even as he's gone up there and he's just got a fresh deposit into his life, I pray that, Lord, as he takes the time just to spend time with you, God, as he gets up and he shares next week, his ministry will be on a whole new level. So we pray increase over his life in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for this church body. We thank you for every single person who's here this morning. And I pray that as your word goes out, that you'd speak into the hearts of people. I pray this morning that your word will fall upon good ground and it will produce a harvest. We come against distraction, and we pray at the end of this service that Jesus, you and you alone, will be glorified, honored, magnified, and praised. In Jesus' precious name, and all God's precious and anointed people say, amen. So this morning, first you want to say thank you to Pastor Cully for the opportunity to share God's word. It's always an honor and a privilege to be able to get up here and share God's word. And we're going to continue with our Messy Church series. So this series has been interesting to say the least. 2 weeks ago, we had the service where there were no volunteers. And I was saying at the mall, we started the worship and I was like, I don't want to look back because I was so scared. If I look back, how people were responding, and I know this side was also awkward. But what we've been trying to tell people over the last 2 weeks, we've been speaking about the importance of people volunteering, people getting involved and using their gifts to extend the kingdom of God. Now, this morning I want to speak about the other side, because Pastor Cully can get up here and he can do a call for volunteers. He can ask you and encourage you to get involved. But unless we create an environment where people can, we need to create an environment where people can actually serve in the house of God. Okay? And I was, you know, we've just through talking to different people, I was in a life group a few weeks ago and realizing how many people have at some time, I pray it's not here, but at some time, maybe you've been at another church and you've got involved and you started volunteering and you decided to be involved in a team or just got involved in ministry. And what happens is you had a negative experience. Somebody hurt you. Maybe you were abused through the process in terms of like you were just used and abused and you were just a number. And it's easy. There are a lot of people who are put off from serving because they've had a negative experience. Now, the reality is, and I can say this on behalf of Pastor Cully, I promise you, true story, we cannot fully isolate you from pain. People are people. I'd love to stand up here and say after this message that Sweetwater is going to be a church where everyone's going to celebrate everybody and love everybody. But the reality is people are people. And people are going to let you down, including the person in front of you. Because we are people, okay? But I believe that each one of us play a part in creating an environment for a healthy culture to create. All of us play an important part in creating an environment for a healthy culture for people to serve. And so every one of you play a part. So this morning I want to speak about creating a culture of honor. Now, I'm going to say this at the beginning, because when you hear that word, some of you were like, honor. And you're like, you might be want to switch over. Can I tell you why? Because over the years, this in many churches has been preached from the perspective of getting people to honor the pastors and the leadership of churches. And sadly, this message has been used to manipulate people and to almost make the pastor into a mini celebrity, where the man of God becomes almost like God. I want to tell you something. That is not the culture of honor that we want at Sweetwaters. Let me say that again. That is not the culture of honor that we want at Sweetwaters. And if this has been your experience, whether it's here or it's been somewhere else, I pray that as you listen to God's word, that God will shine his truth around this important topic. So firstly, what is honor? The word honor literally means giving weight, as in the weight of coins or gold. But let me give the simple definition, because I'm a simple oak. Honor simply speaks about giving people value. Simply put, honor means to value someone highly. Now, why do we honor people? Why do we honor people? Well, I have a box here. Now, some of you might have come and say, oh, my word, hallelujah, prize giveaway, Jesus, a Nike box. And you're like, I hope that's my size. Some of you might have like got your, I see smartphones, like, let's just zoom in and see if it's my size. Okay, let me give you the bad news. It's empty. Sorry, the board wouldn't approve a prize. No, just joking. No, but if I were to say to you and say, so here's Chris, this is Chris, he's awesome, wearing a Springbok shirt, and he's like, Chris, I said, Chris, you know, you're such a good friend of mine. You know, we've been friends for a long time. We've bride together. You're so amazing. I've got a special gift for you. This gift is from the bottom of my heart. And I give him this empty box. Firstly, he's going to look at me like I'm smoking something. It's like, isn't there meant to be something in the box? His wife will give, he might be quiet, but you know the wife is always going to say what they really feel. All the men say, don't say amen too loud, you'll be in trouble. The reality is this box, although it has a Nike tick on it, has some tattered corners. It's got some tears in it. It's not a very impressive box. It's gone through the storage. The label's a bit messed up and everything. But, and if I gave this to Chris, Chris might be really nice and say, oh, yeah, put a little smile on his face. But I can tell you something. He might look after the box for 5 minutes. He might leave church in the box. He might even leave it under a seat. If he's such a holy and anointed man, he might even take it home. And when he gets home, if I went in a week and said, Chris, where's that box? You're like, I have no idea. It would land on the rubbish. But let's say for a moment, I opened this box and there was a brand new pair of Nikes in here. $1,999 rand. And I gave it to Chris. Can I tell you something? Firstly, he'd be super grateful. He would look off this box with his life. I promise you something, this box would probably be on his lap in church. If he walks out of church, he'll make sure he doesn't leave it behind. He will watch all of you. All of you will become suspicious, even the pastors. And then he gets home. I promise you something, he'd look after this. Church, you would place more value on the box because of what it contained. Now, church, this is the reason we value people, because of what they contain, because of what they carry. The people sitting around you, to your left, to your right, in front of you, behind you, the people that you like, and even the people that you might not like as much. The truth is, they are carriers of something a lot more precious than money could ever buy. Bible says in 1 Corinthians 3 verse 16, do you not know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in you? Church, the people around you, they might look a bit insignificant at times, but can I tell you something? They are carriers of the very presence of God. This is why we treat people with honor. We don't honor them because of their performance. We don't honor them because of what they do. We don't honor them because of their title. We honor them because of who they carry. Church, sometimes the outer casing is a bit of a mess, but they are carriers of the presence of God, the very person of God. And I believe this is why it's critically important that we treat the people around us with honor, because they carry the very presence of God. Secondly, we also honor people because they have been made in the image of God. the people around us and the people who we encounter on a day on a day-to-day basis are a lot more valuable than we'll ever realize. They are because of who they carry and because of whose in whose image they are created. But let's look at what the Bible says around this. Let's look at honor through Scripture. Now, let's be real and honest for a moment. Maybe this is just me, but I'm sure this is not just me. Sometimes it's easier to honor people in positions of influence and authority. So let me just say this first, and there's nothing wrong with this. So just hold your horses. Don't jump to the conclusion. After the service, the pastor preaches, and man, the hordes will come. Oh, Pastor Cully, great message. He's so anointed. He's so awesome. People will line up. And they want to honor the man of God. They want to celebrate. There's nothing wrong with that. I just want to say there's nothing wrong with that. They want to spend time in his presence. At work on a Monday, when the boss walks in, you treat him differently. You treat him with respect. You treat him with dignity. You make sure you say the right things to him. But here's what I want to get to. It's important that we sometimes check our motives. Why do we do this? Could it be sometimes that we honor people in positions of authority and influence because we have more to gain by honoring them? You honor your boss more, guess what? It could affect your bank account. It could lead to a promotion. Some people, they come to a church. Let me just say, and this is not this church, other churches. They come to church and they'll honor the man of God. You know what? They want a title. True story? Honor with an agenda is not honor at all. You don't honor people to get something from them. As soon as there's an agenda attached to it, you are missing the very point of what honor looks like. When it comes to honoring people, we need to ask ourselves the question again and again, are we honoring people for the right reasons? Luke 14, verse 13 to 14, look at what Jesus says. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. So Jesus says, don't just seek to bless those who can repay you, but even seek to bless people who can give you absolutely nothing in return. And I believe this principle applies to honor, because here's the thing. When you honor people who can repay you, the reward will be from them. When you honor people who cannot repay you, your reward is from God. And I don't know where you want the reward from. Can I tell you something? Do you know where promotion comes from? From the Lord. When you honor with the right motives, God will sort your promotion. God will lift you up. God will open doors that need to be opened. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul speaks about the different gifts and talents in the body of Christ. And he uses the parts of the body to explain this. He speaks about the eye and the ear and the mouth and everything. And he says it's important to make sure that every part of the body function in the correct way so the body of Christ can grow. Now, let's be real. Even in the natural, it's a lot easier to sometimes honor the parts that we see the most. So when you wake up in the morning, I promise you something. Those who are wearing shoes, some of the men haven't even cut their toenails for the last 6 months. Disgusting thought. Until they wear the slops and it's like these claws are coming over the end. But you know what? Your face, you spend a lot of time looking after. The ladies put lipstick and they put stuff on their eyes, whatever they call all this eyebrow stuff and all that type of stuff. They do their hair. They get their hair colored. They get haircuts at good hairdressers and that kind of thing. We take the time and we take more time looking after the parts that people notice the most. But let me tell you something. I can prove to you that every single part of your body is important. Get up in the middle of the night when your hair is a mess. There's no makeup. Maybe you've got one of those green masks in your face that look like you are gonna in a horror movie. Don't put the lights on and walk around the room tonight. Kick your little toe. Every single part of your body will react. You'll forget about your face. You'll forget about your makeup. You'll forget about whether you got your hair, no hair, done, wig, whatever. You'll forget about all of that. And all you'll think about is your little toe. And church, sometimes we pay more attention to the parts of the body that are prominent. When there's other smaller parts of the body that are hurting, we forget about them. 1 Corinthians 12, Paul says, "The eye cannot say to the hand, you have no need of it, nor to the head, nor again to the head, to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable." This means absolutely necessary. And on those parts of the body we think are less honorable, we bestow the greater honor, and the unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it. You know what? It's amazing that we have a man of God that preaches the word well. But can I just say this? If it wasn't for the little toes in the back on the sound, if it wasn't for the cameraman, you wouldn't hear what is being preached. Can I tell you something? It's important that somebody preaches. It's important we have the mouths. It's important we have the ears, the prophets, and all that. But it's just as important that we have the people that play the small part, because every single part is important for the body of Christ to function correctly. If somebody loses their toe, do you know what it'll do? It'll affect the way they walk. Sometimes the body is wonky because we forget about the little toe. And I want you to say, just on a side note, if you're a little toe in the body of Christ, you matter. Church, if you're a little toe, if you feel you're insignificant, every single part of the body of Christ matters. The foundation of honor is love. Without genuine love, there is no way we'll honor people. Jesus says in Matthew 22, verse 37 to 39, and he said to them, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and the first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." First and foremost, we are called to love God. We are called to honor God above everything else. We need to honor people, but higher than that, we need to honor God. But then Jesus tells us, and look what it says. This is the first and greatest. The second is like it. He tells us to love our neighbor. You know, you hear this statement, and we've probably all said it in jest before. You know, the Lord's easy, but his people, yo. Anyone ever said that before? Don't put your hand up. The reality is the one doesn't go without the other. If we're believers, we're called to both love God and we're called to love people. Love is the foundation of honor. But I want you to notice the last part of the verse. Love your neighbor as yourself. You know, sometimes the reason we struggle to love other people is because of the way we see ourselves. Sometimes the reason we treat people the way we do is not because of who they are, but it's because of who we are. When you meet someone who's just secure in the identity in Christ, and you meet someone who's just secure and they just know who they are, I promise you something, they will treat people with honor, dignity, and respect. Have you ever looked in the mirror in the morning? You literally will wake up in the morning and there'll be like a little pimple that will form behind your ear in the darkest crevice behind your ear. You know, like your parents said, where the cabbages grow? Anyone's promised that? And you know what? You'll look in the mirror in the morning, you'll miss your beautiful eyes. You'll miss your perfect eyebrows, your amazing eyelashes. You'll miss every part of them. You'll be like, yo, there's a pimple behind my ear. And you know what will happen the whole day? You'll say, "Hi, Kathy, how are you doing?" "Well, she must be just noticing this pimple behind my ear." And everyone you're wondering if they just see it. Anyone else like me? Sometimes we look in the mirror and we see the ugly stuff easier than, or the stuff that we perceive as less attractive, easier than we see the stuff that is attractive. And we often are very aware of our shortcomings. And because of this, a lot of people struggle with in areas of a healthy self-identity. And here's the reality. Sometimes you can be confident in one area, but you have self-identity issues in other areas. The truth is that we sometimes see other, we often see other people through the lens with which we see ourselves. We need to ask God to correct the lens. We need to ask the Father to help us see ourselves through the honor of the correct lens. So I want to look at honor in action. How does this happen in the church, and how does this happen in real life? Okay, I'm going to start with the verse that Pastor Cullen never asked me to preach this, but I'm going to start with this verse because it's in the Bible. 1 Timothy 5 verse 17 says this here. We are called to honor those who preach God's word. Look at what it says. It's in the Bible. Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of honor. Does it say that? It says double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. It doesn't just say we need to honor those who preach the word of God. We need to give them double honor. Now, I wanted to go back and look at what this meant because and none of my study Bibles really gave me the honor, but there were a lot of websites with famous theologians and guys who had studied the word of God, and they said something interesting. They say it speaks about giving both respect and financial support. Respect and financial support. We are called to honor those who preach the word of God, not just with our respect, but we are also called to bless them financially. Now, we know there are excesses again. Hear what I'm saying? There are excesses where somebody comes up and preaches, and I won't preach unless you give me $1 million. We're not talking about the excesses, and don't let the excesses of some destroy what God's word wants to say. This is why as a church, when people come and preach, can I be honest with you? We will bless them financially. Can we say that again? When people come to preach, we will bless them financially. Because we're a church that believes in the word of God. Amen? So to go back to early on, it is important. When Pastor Cully preaches, I'm encouraging you. Say amen. Bring your faith. Bring your expectation to church. I promise you, when you get excited, he preaches better. When you go after the church and say, Pastor Cully, that word just spoke into my life. Can I tell you something? He preaches better the next week. Send him a message on Monday. Say, send a message to the church. Say, just thank you so much. It was that word really spoke into my life. It's important that we bless those that we honor those who share the word of God. So the first part, I want to say it's biblical, but honor doesn't stop there. 1 Peter 2 verse 17. I'm just going to read the first two words. It says this here. Honor everyone. Honor everyone. We're not only called to honor those who preach God's word, we are called to honor everyone. And remember what I said to you earlier, we honor people because of who they carry and whose image they are created in. Okay, now, this might apply more to men. Is anyone here a bit competitive? Be honest. Who doesn't like losing? Everything you play, I'm going to win this. Okay, let's be real. Any bad losers here? Thank the Lord there's honest people in the house of God. Give them a round of applause for their honesty. But I want to give you a competition. We can all do it. The Bible actually tells us there's a verse that says this. There's a little competition we can take on. Romans 12 verse 10 says this is how we can compete. Love one another with brotherly affection. The foundation of honor is love. Outdo one another in showing honor. It's almost like we come to church. I know this is not, it's stretching a little bit, but it's almost like, Pastor Cully, I'm going to honor you. And Pastor Cully's like, I will honor you better. And it's almost like this honor competition. And it's not like, there's no vindictive motive. You know what I'm saying? Not so you can get me to say, oh, just to let you guys know, myself and Pastor Cully had an honor competition this week. I'm the winner. It's not for that reason. The idea here is that we need to be a people that are constantly looking for reason to honor people. It's important to honor those who preach, but why stop there? What about the other people in the body of Christ? Let me ask you a question. When last We got Chris in the back. Chris, give us a wave. When last did you go to Chris and say, Chris, I just want to thank you every Sunday morning. You do an amazing job with the sound. And he does. He does an amazing job with the sound. When last did you go to the projection and say, you know what, you helped me. I could see the words. I was actually able to worship God because of the words on the screen. When last did you go to your sectioners and say, you know what, you made me feel welcome. When last did you go to the team at the door? When last, if you have kids in your children's church, you just go, let me get my kids and take them home. When last did you go to the teacher and say, I just want to say, I'm really grateful for taking the time. When last did you go to the worship and say, Laura and Francois, you guys and the rest of the team, you guys did so well. This is what I believe this scripture looks like. When last did you go to the camera guys and say, you know what, when I was sick, I was able to watch church because of you filming. I can guarantee, this is the rebuke part, I can guarantee on a Sunday if the camera guy, let me say this, in 3 months if the camera guy gets one person besides the team saying, well done, it's a miracle. We are called to outdo one another with honor. Yes, honor the man of God. Biblical. But don't stop there. Look for opportunity to honor every single people. Here's the truth. When you honor people, we let them know they are loved and we let them know they are appreciated. And like, you know what will happen? We spoke about the bad part earlier. It makes their serving an absolute joy. And here's a little secret. They will start to serve better. Let's be a church that outdoes one another with honor. So Jesus is the ultimate model of what honor looks like. And I read an article this week, and this is not my term, but it's they said this year, that Jesus was the ultimate noticer. Let's be honest for a moment. Life is busy. There's always a demand list. There's always things we have to do. And sometimes it's the busyness of the world. Sometimes it's religious activity. And what happens is we get so busy that we don't always notice the people around us. Church, when you are too busy to notice what is happening in the lives of the people around you, you are too busy. John 5 verse 5, Jesus noticed a particular man who had been living with his disability for 38 years. He knew this man had been waiting for a long time. In Matthew 19, Jesus noticed his disciples were teaching children like they were annoying, but Jesus made sure that everybody knew they were welcome and wanted. In Mark 5, Jesus noticed that someone had touched his robe, and he turned around, and he showed this woman kindness, and she was healed. In John 9, verse 1, Jesus noticed the blind man and helped him get healed. In Luke, verse 19, Jesus noticed Zacchaeus, in a tree, a short man in a tree. And the man had an encounter with Jesus that changed his heart. You see, church, sometimes honor simply means we need to see people and take time to show them how valuable they are. Sometimes we need to just in church say, Lord, give us the ability to see and take the time to try and notice the people around you. Sometimes honor is simply us taking the time to listen to someone. I went yesterday to the grief care, and it's an amazing group of people, and all they do there is they just take the time to listen. And that's what honor looks like. Honor is taking the time to listen. You know, the problem with most of us, me included, is that as soon as a person starts to talk, we already know the answer. Sometimes people don't need the answer, they just need your ears. We need to take time to hear their story, to show them a care. So let's talk about, as I close, how can we do this practically? And I'm going to end off here. How do we do this practically? I want to ask you, are you ready to develop the habit of honor in your life? Anyone ready for that this morning? Okay. So, first, I just want to say thank you. I went to a life group with Esther and them. This is where this whole message was birthed. So, I don't know if Esther's here this morning. Esther here? Yeah, you're getting the message. Okay, cool. Just to honor you guys. So let's talk about how we can practically, there's two things we do. Very easy. Number one, allow the Lord to minister to you. 1 John 4 verse 19, we love because he first loved us. We love because he first loved us. Church, loving people and loving God is not a result of religious effort. You can't walk out and say, my mantra this week is, I am going to love people more. You probably will fail. when you understand the incredible love that Father God has for you, the overflow of that is that we're able to love people. What's interesting is Jesus does his whole life, and when he starts his ministry, before he does any ministry, he has an encounter with his Father. And the Bible says he's baptized with, by John the Baptist baptizes him. And as he comes out the water, the Bible says the heavens are opened. And then the voice from heaven, the Father says, "This is my dearly loved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." Before Jesus did anything, he heard the voice of his Father saying, "This is my dearly loved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." You need to ask the Father to show you the love that he has for you. This is why, church, it's so important that we spend time in Scripture. And when you read the word, don't look for rules and regulations. Can I tell you something? Look for what the Father says about you. Look for how much love he has for you. Number one, ask the Father to show how much he loves you. Number two, practical. Find five people every day to honor and celebrate. Make it a habit. Now, a little tip you can do, if you go online, you can literally download a habit tracker. So as a habit tracker, say, I'm going to honor five people today. Now, you might say, isn't this religious? No, it's making a deliberate decision that you are going to do it, because you're going to start thinking, oh, I can chat to this person, I can do this to this person. And some days you're going to get it right, and some days you're going to get it wrong. But what you are doing is you're actually planning to honor. You're making a deliberate decision, because now you're saying, yo, who can I honor? Who's done well? But don't just do this at church. Do this even in your everyday life. You see, church, I've realized something. We are very, very good at finding people or finding people and pointing out their faults. You remember what I said to you earlier? The only time most people go to the sound desk is when the sound is bad. Yeah, Chris, my ears, they were like bleeding. I wanted to put earplugs and I can't believe it. Chris, you guys are terrible. Chris, the words are too small. We love catching people when they get it wrong. We love it. It's something in us. But how different would church look if we, instead of catching people getting wrong, that we look for opportunity to catch people doing good? We start looking for opportunity to when somebody does well, we want to make sure that we want to celebrate them. We want to go to them and say, "You did such a fantastic job." I'm going to give you permission to gossip this morning. Give you permission. How different would gossiping look if instead of saying, "Yo, do you see what Chris was wearing today? Oh, I can't believe it. I can't believe it." You hear what I'm saying? How different would it be if the gossip about it is Chris? Chris is such a good friend. That oak has got such a servant heart. And we talk, that's the conversation that is happening behind the scenes. Let's learn to gossip about people, but to say good things about them behind their backs. How would that look differently, eh? So church, look for five people every day. If you really want to build the habit, take the time, and what you do is you make the decision. At the end of the day, look back and take the time to reflect on how you did. And now let me ask you another question, how you feel about it. Can I tell you something? If you start practicing this, because it's in the Word of God, I'm going to make a promise to you. You'll start feeling better about yourself. True story. You'll feel, it'll become like a good drug. You'll feel so pumped every day. So I want to find more and more people. And you know, if you do this for 21 days, you know what happens? It starts to become a habit. We honor people not because of what they do. Instead, we honor people not because of what they do. It's because of who they carry and whose image they are created. And I believe this. If we get this right as a church, we will create a culture where people will want to serve and they'll want to give you the giftings. Let's stand this morning. We worship you, Jesus. Father, we thank you this morning that your word says that we love because you first loved us. I pray for each and every person here, God. I thank you, Lord, for the people that are part of this church, your precious, precious children. Your word says that, Lord, you love them with an everlasting love. Thank you, Lord, that they are fearfully and wonderfully made, that they've been made in your glorious image. Thank you, Father, that as you look at people here today, people might look at them as ordinary people, but God, I thank you that, Lord, they are extraordinary because of whose image they were created, and then secondly, because they carry the very presence of God within them. I pray that from today as a church, we would see people through a different lens. I pray that you would help us to see people through the eyes of Jesus. That, Father, we would, when we see people around them, we would not just see them as ordinary people, but, Lord, we would start to celebrate them as a people who are created in the image of God and who carry the very presence of God. Father, I pray that through the power of your Spirit, for each one of us, God, that we would move, we would become a church that practices honor. We will honor those who share the word of God. But Lord, more than that, we'll also honor the people who serve in the house faithfully every single week. Father, I pray that Sweetwater's Church, we would become known as a church where we outdo one another in love, where we outdo one another in honor, where we look for opportunities to honor people, where people feel they won't feel tolerated, but they'll know that they are celebrated. We praise you. We worship you, God. Do a work in our hearts, we pray. Forgive us, Lord, where we have become critical. Forgive us where we have moved out of love. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us where we have sought to honor people to get something from them. Forgive us, God. Purify our motives, God. Lord, fill our hearts with your love. Fill our hearts with your love, God. Come on, church. Just ask him for a couple of moments. Just fill our hearts with your love. Come on, church. Just lift your voice. Just pray. Cry at him for a moment. Come, church. Come on, church. Ask him to fill your heart with his love this morning. A fresh revelation. Oh, Jesus, show them your incredible love this morning, God. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. We love because you first loved us. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. Give us a fresh perspective on the people around us, God. We worship you. We honor you, God.